that I will be recording this meeting. I hope none of you has some objections, right? That is the only reason I came here at the first place in this new meeting room. So I have your permissions, all of you, right? You can write in the chat box also if you don't want to put on your mic. Hello, am I audible?
Yes, you are audible, and I think you should start now.
Okay, okay. So, coming back to the presentation, as you can see, this is my title slide, Probing COVID-19 Outbreak Datasets with R. So, yes, I did some work on the COVID-19, especially data analysis with the language R, and which is also a software kind of thing. So without doing much ado, let us talk about our outline of the talk. So I will not go into the details, but there are two parts in my talk. That two part is parts are, one is motivation, another one is methodology. So once you have motivation, and another one is methodology. In the motivation part, you should not be falling asleep, and in the methodology part, you may not be awake, because it will be meat of the talk and it will be slightly more detailed and etc. So let us go into, this is the abstract. Many of you have seen it, so I will skip this. And let us go to the subject of this study. So let us see why, what is an outbreak and why do we study it? How do we study it? There was some debate going on with my colleagues, especially with my friends who were in this institute, MNIT, or maybe some friends who are outside but who are college friends. I was discussing that everybody, including the World Health Organization, is duping us, is not giving us information. That means how, that means who initially declined it spread from human to human. But later it was found that it actually spreads human to human. Then they declined stopping over the international traffic, especially the airways traffic. They said it causes stigma, but then they actually backtracked on that advisory also. Then they delayed the declaration of a pandemic up till 11th of March or something, if I remember correctly. So that was a kind of a very dilly-dallying and lackadaisical decision. And so I was saying that who is not doing its duty, discharging its responsibilities properly. One of my colleagues told me, if you want to hold something, someone liable, or if you want to put the responsibility somewhere, you should know something about it first. And that is where, that was a tipping point, I started doing some work. So I now know that many of the things that the newspapers are telling us is not right. And even if they're telling us, they're telling us in a much delayed fashion. So without much further ado, let us start epidemiology. Now let us see what is epidemiology. So this is a situation, actually this is a 2 weeks back situation, not last week. This is a 2 weeks back situation in Daejeon. Daejeon is a city, relatively big city in Republic of Korea, where I was there for 2 years. It is stolen from Facebook, from the wall of Professor Arman Shafilu, who works in KASI, Korea Astronomy and Space Institute. He is an Iranian, but he passed out from Pune only. He graduated from Pune with his PhD. Maybe many of you in this group also maybe knowing him. I met him in Korea. So he actually painstakingly charted out the situation. The Daejeon is undergoing a second wave there. So if I can read correctly, this is patient number 47 somewhere here. And this person has infected somebody called 51. Similarly, 49 has infected five of them actually, including 72. 61 is a super spreader. He has infected many, maybe 7 or 8, etc. But some of them, just like this fellow, let's say 48, he has not infected any patient. So this is how actually epidemiology goes. Who infects whom, and how does it spreads? It's just like a pastry gossip, just like who is going out with whom, who is seeing whom. But I'm talking about general epidemiology. It's not in particular about acquired immunodeficiency syndrome. So don't get ideas, right? And so contact tracing is very important here. And we should not, for a small cluster, this is manageable. You can do it on a blackboard or a whiteboard. But using a huge database, it is better to do it on a computer. So in computer, we use two types of data. One is line listing, another one is contact listing. Contact listing is also known as infector-infective pair. So I will show you two of my databases, which has been taken from 30th January 2020 and up till 19th of April 2020. So this is where India could actually gather contact pairs. But after that, the epidemic spread, and they actually stopped collecting this contact pair information. So here is my data. This is the line list. Here you can see the patient ID, patient numerical ID. There are some age brackets, sex, date of onset of clinical symptoms, city, patient fallen ill, and district, etc. So actually there were more columns, and the data were not terminating in number 10th patient. There were actually 17,000 and few hundred data points in the line list. So, but for presentation purpose, I have used a small slice just to give you some idea or some feel about it. So here is my contact list. It has nothing but a directed list where the person infecting, that means who is the infector and who is the infectee. That information is of vital importance here, but it does not have any other data like date, age, sex, and etc. So this line list is something like when we used to chat 20 years or 30 years back over online, we used to ask the person from the other end, like, what is your ASL? That means age, sex, location. We were not used to asking names or the status of his or her father, kaun se gharane se ho, ye hume nahi puchna tha. Just some anonymized data set, ASL will do. So the contact list here, you can see this is a contact list here is a directed line segment, which we have done by using the directed thing through. We have put the directed thing through and we made a vector list there. So let us go ahead. Why we are collecting this kind of a data set, which is of course publicly available. I have not collected anything myself. I have just downloaded from the GitHub. So let us go ahead. Go ahead again and see that this is my serial interval. So what can be done with line list and contact list? First thing is we can create serial interval. I will come to that. Again, we can create cluster size distribution. You will get to know about it very soon. Again, we can also create nodes and edges chart. You will, if you don't know about it, you will get to know very soon in 3-4 slides. But why are you trying to do this kind of things with our data? First thing first, from the serial interval, you will get to know what is the recovery time and what are the policy interventions that the government should implement for its citizens. From cluster size, you can actually discuss about whether the disease is in community spread mode or is in super spreading mode. And from the nodes and edges chart, you can actually see if asymptomatic persons are transmitting the disease or not. Then there are other things like index clustering of the members and what are the possibilities of herd immunity, etc. These are the things you can actually possibly gather by yourself. So let us press ahead. So what is a serial interval? So whenever a person is exposed with the virus or maybe a bacterium, not all epidemics or infectious disease are borne by viruses. There are bacteria also that can create infectious disease. So whenever a susceptible person is exposed, he gets some viral or bacterial load, he undergoes then an incubation period. That incubation period actually prepares him to show clinical symptoms. That means there will be a cytokine storm and he will be kind of a bimaru kind of a thing. He will be ill. So that illness, the clinical support of illness will come whenever he is or she is already incubated. Only one virus entering a susceptible person will not show symptoms. It has to be bred, well bred, and he will show clinical symptoms. And during that time also, which is known as the latent period, he will also be infectious to others. That means if he is a primary person, the secondary person ko transmit karne ke liye, to transmit it to the secondary person, he need to undergo another period, which is known as latent period. Not that they are mutually exclusive. They run along together. But these two periods are not exactly of same duration. One may be larger than the other one or vice versa. And it actually changes from person to person. So you never know if a person's incubation period is longer, then he will show clinical symptoms later and vice versa. So if the latent period is longer, he will be infectious to others later. But if it is smaller, then he will be infectious much faster. So between the difference between these two clinical symptoms are also known as serial interval or generation time. So if we try to plot this thing, if we try to plot a date of onsets of each patient, and since we know who infected whom, we might be able to plot the serial interval, because we are assuming here that the date of onset is where the serial interval lies. Actually, I have made a little bit of an approximation here. It is not exactly date of onset. It is actually your date of reportage. Because main kab bimar pada apne ghar pe, nobody knows. But whenever I was reported to the authorities, that everybody knows. And I assume that this distribution is normal. There is the distribution of delay has a mean. That is what I am assuming in normality case. So when we plot it, we find this kind of an data. And this should come to you as a shock. So some person are infectious up to 15 days to others. Some are up to 26 days. Some are up to 45 days. And there are two clusters here, very small. There are instances where people have infected up to 58 days. Let that sink in for 30 seconds. So this is not I am talking to you. This is data is talking to you. And that data is actually taken. This is publicly available data. It's not me doing it. Everybody can do it. Whoever is versed with R can do it. So this is only from 30th January to 19th April. Whatever happened later, we don't know. So this is our serial interval. Now let us go to the cluster size distribution. Now the cluster size distribution shows a very disturbing feature. So these bar actually shows this cluster is of size 1. So this actually is showing that there are 16,612 persons are there who are basically orphan infectees whose parents were never found. Why this is so? This is because of the fact that our contact list was not as complete as our line list. Line list had 17,000 and a few hundred figures in them. But in our contact list, there were only around 759 contacts that could be made pairwise. So what it means that most of them were orphans whose infectious fathers could never be traced back. So this disturbing cluster size distribution has come up. The 16,612 are orphan infectees, and then there are cluster sizes. There are cluster sizes of 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, so on and so forth. The highest cluster size is 66. And you should note, there are only 66 head in the 66 cluster size. Similarly, 26 may 26, and in 22 size cluster size, there are only 22 persons. But in 17, there are only 17. In 14, there are only 14 persons. But in the 12, size number 12, there are 72 persons. That means during that time, 30th January to 19th April, there were around 6 clusters of 12 persons strong. There were around 6 firing squads. So this is how R can help you doing your analysis. And why this cluster size is important? Because this is a bar plot, by the way. And whatever this bar plot does not show you can be seen from here. This is a cluster index size plot. So it actually shows you that from 66 to 26, there is a huge gap. These gaps are the gaps in our data. What we could not tell. What we can tell is okay, but what we could not tell is this. So the thing is, this is the orphan line. This orphan line actually shows you 16,612 persons who are fatherless, infectious fatherless. So we cannot tell anything about them, but I am still within that time, 30th January to 19th April, I will not, and if your cluster size distribution has more infectees who are basically orphan, people say this is community transmission because you don't know who infected whom. But this is because of our lethargic data transmission, data information, that this orphan infectees are ruling the roost. But this is not the case. Up to 19th April, there was no chance of community infection. You all know that. And the cluster sizes are so small that you can tell that there was no community transmission there. Now, there were, of course, you can see there are only one 66 size cluster, one 26 cluster size, one 22 cluster size. But what about this number two? So number two may be one infected two, three infected four, five infected six, or something like that. Or it may so happen one infected something around 15,000, because here in the below side, this is the number of index, and index is the patient ID. So here also, we do not know who infected whom. It may so happen this person infected this, and this person infected this, and so on and so forth. It may also happen that this person has infected this person, but we don't know. So we have to actually gather what is the ID of this person. Only a simple graph cannot tell you that. So we have to do it in a smart way, what R allows you to do. So we can do a plotting, which is known as nodes and edges chart. Who is infecting whom and how many he is infecting directly and then indirectly. this type of plotting is known as nodes and edges chart. So let us see. So this is our nodes and edges chart. This is the biggest cluster, which had 66 members. And you can see, but you cannot read probably, because I also can't, that all of these nodes, all of these blobs has a number associated with them. There are 66 balls in here, and he or she is the, I know it is a he is the father. And he has directly or indirectly has infected 65 other persons here. So let us see how many he has infected and what is his identity. His identity is patta number 689. If you can read this, you can see it is patta number 689. And he has infected up to the last person, which is 16,068. And you can see that this is a direct connection. This connection is direct. He has infected this person directly. So you can see here that this person has infected this person directly, which is over 15,000 and which is less than 1,000, which is shown here. So how many person he has infected directly? I could read, count up to the arrows. I can see 39 of them. Actually, I did it in my leisure time. I'm not doing it here. But I can tell you for the record, he has infected 39 persons on his personal behalf. And last person was 16,068. And he was infected on 26th March. And he infected last around 19th April. So how many days? 24, 25 days. So whatever your government is telling you that 15 days quarantine reh jao, आपका भला होगा, भगवान आपका भला करेगा. This is just bullshit. Throw it just as you throw it like a bull crap. And you don't know who is duping you. Your government or it is World Health Organization, nobody knows. But this is what data says. And this person, this father of 65 proud infectees, is a 35 years old male from Mysuru. And in Karnataka, there is actually a cases of super spreading also. If you have read your newspapers carefully, you should be knowing it. So data actually never lies, and you actually get to know your information by yourself. That is why I'm doing R. Nothing, I'm not going to become a big shot in epidemiology anytime soon. So now let us press ahead. So how did I do that? I could do it by doing some code R responsibilities. This is my code R. This is actually a 10 line codes. Out of them, 3 lines are basically library lines. Outbreak library, epicontacts library, anytime library, and etc. And this is a function. These are basically single lines. These are actually data file reading commands. And I'm making a list, and list has been made into a epicontact object, and then I can get the cluster size and cluster table. That means how many heads in one cluster and how many clusters like them. We can do it. Only 10 lines of code can give you this type of graph. And I can tell you that all the graphs are actually results of 10 lines each. So anybody can do it. And especially a person who is maybe 10, 15 years younger in age can do wonders with R. So code R is very important. So let us press ahead again. This is our second topic. How did I get this much of a learning material? So I got everything about whatever I have learned, like serial interval, generation time, growth rate, and doubling time, reproduction number, force of infection, and etc. I got it from two blogs. I actually read only blogs, not papers, because blogs actually help you to understand things with much clarity. And papers are just like Sam Benegal movies, art house movies. Unless you are smoking cigarette or grass, you cannot understand them. Suraj ka Satma Ghora. But if you are looking at David Dhawan movies, you will probably understanding it far better than those movies. So I was reading a blog, an Australian healthcare professional called Tim Church. He's actually one of the first 10 top resource person in R doing epidemiology on COVID-19. And another one is a professor called Holger Diedrich. And this Holger Diedrich is a German person, as you might have guessed. But and he's a professor, and he may be rich, but he's living, and he's still blogging with the head of Learning Machines. His blog's name is Learning Machines. So he's very much alive. So actually, from these blogs, I could get to know there are two consortiums. One is known as R Epidemic Consortium, and another one is RAP, from which I could actually learn many things, and many of the codes were found there. I will also tell you as I go along. And that is why I actually endeavored into this type of a job. So since I have learned many things after reading blogs, I will press ahead. So how to find hotspots? So these are the things that we do. How to find hotspots? So this is a kind of a Cleveland dot plot chart, Cleveland dot chart, where we have plotted, let's say, top 10 states like West Bengal, Uttar Pradesh, Tamil Nadu, dated on this date. And you can see that how many has been tested positive there, and what is the case fatality rates. And you can see this abscissa is log scale. Since the abscissa is log scale, you can actually see that that this is kind of a distance modulus kind of a thing. So you should know how far in log scale the death to positives ratio is. So you should know your top 10 in terms of cases and deaths. And these are the symbols, deceased and positives, etc. So you can do another types of hotspot modeling, which is known as the number of tests performed and what percentage of them are positive and what percentage of them are actually deceased. As you can see, all the states are showing 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, but they are not actually 0 because of this log scale. Here it is maybe 0.02, but in the case of Gujarat, it is around, let's say, 0.6 or something. Maharashtra may be same hai. So this is the 1% mark. So why I use these two types of Cleveland dot chart? Why I do this kind of a dot chart, a Cleveland dot chart in measuring the hotspot? Because of the fact is that some states might artificially do small number of testing. In that case, you may never enter the top 10 in the cases and case fatality rate charts. But if you do the test chart and test fatality rate chart, they cannot escape. They will be caught. So that is why I have done two types of dot chart, and where I could found which are the top 10 tests, top 10 states in India. But these situations are actually very much fluid also. You can see every passing 10 days, the situation actually changes. And you can see Bihar has, on this day, 26th of May is a very important day in my life. And on that day, I have plotted this case number chart. And I have seen Bihar has also entered top 10, briefly though. And I have seen the case fatality rate is very small in Bihar. But still, in the case number, it has entered top 10. So now let us go to our meat of the talk. What is the mathematics of the outbreak? So mathematics of the outbreak is basically an exponential growth model, which many of you have started understanding it. It is the probability of communicating a hostless infectious. Mind it, because since it is this infection spreads from man to man. This infection spreads from man to man. There is no intermediate vectors. That means koi kira, makora, yeah, there are no rats like in bubonic plague and etc. There are no vectors. So you have only a human to human communicable disease. So there are no intermediaries. So it is, so in the transmission risk is known as the probability of communicating a hostless infectious disease upon contact or meeting. So I'm not only talking about HIV or something. So here contact and meeting means I can meet you from 2 meters apart, and still if I am exposed, I may infect, or vice versa. It can go both ways. Set this to one, and if the disease recovery takes only 1 day and each infected person keeps meeting susceptible individuals at a constant rate of 2 persons only, then it will imply that the number of sick people will double each day, as shown in the figure. And there is a formula for it. Y is the number of cases, and the number of cases increases 2 to the power t minus 1. If the transmission probability was 1 and the person has met 3 persons each day, all infected person met 3 persons every day, then it will be 3 to the power time minus 1, something like that. Now it is up to you to calculate how many will be infected at this current rate after the end of the week. This should be easy. And the twist is, in how much time a population of 2.5 million, 25 lakh, Rajasthan ka adha, 25 lakh people can be totally infected. And now redo the problem by just changing the transmission risk. Transmission risk was 1. Just reduce it to half. If the transmission risk is halved, then how much time does it take? And probably you will be surprised if you could do this second problem. You will be a new, matlab kya bol rahe, new enlightenment or renaissance will dawn upon you. Mathematically, this is a small formula. It does not ring a bell. But if you can do this second problem, it will. So let us press ahead a little bit farther. So growth rate and doubling times can be actually fitted in R and in Python or whatever. You can actually fit. This is the left hand pane is the Rajasthan, and the right hand pane is of Maharashtra. And I have fitted them with log linear models and nonlinear exponential models also. As you can see, nonlinear exponential model, the saffron ones, actually fits the later parts of the epidemic. And log linear models, the blue part, actually fits the lower part of the epidemic. Why it happens? Because mathematically, log linear model and exponential models are the same. Basically, you take log of the incidence y and then fit it with a log linear model, and if you don't take log, you can fit it with the exponential model. Mathematically they are the same, but computationally they are different. So that is why exponential models are more better. It gives you the latter part of the growth rate, and initial part of the growth rate, which is much more exponential, is shown by the log linear model. And I have given you some growth rate here, linear model, non-linear model, that means exponential model. For Maharashtra, case of Maharashtra also, I have given you linear model and non-linear model. For the linear model Rajasthan, it is 0.127, and exponential model Rajasthan, it is 0.0614. For the case of Maharashtra, the linear model has 0.126, and the exponential model for Maharashtra has 0.08 26. Now I have given you the growth rate. It is your job is to calculate the doubling time. Now maybe you are at a loss. Growth rate तो बता दिया बनने ने, लेकिन अब doubling time कैसे निकालेंगे? But many of you, actually most of you, or if not all of you, had plus 2 mathematics or plus 10 physics in your school days, and you probably know what it is known as decay time. From decay rate you can calculate the half lives. From decay rate you calculated half lives. So if I give you the growth rate, it should not take you long to calculate the doubling time. So it is, here is your another job. You can calculate the doubling time for Maharashtra and Rajasthan both, in both the methods. So let us go about our basic reproduction number methodology. Now what is basic reproduction number? But before we go into that, we first look at this slide. Why do you at all care so much about R? So first thing first, it is a threshold parameter determining whether or not there will be an epidemic. It also determines the initial rate of increase of an epidemic, especially at the initial phase, where the growth is truly exponential. Now it may not be. The last three topics, I will actually explain them. So I will just read and brush them aside for now. It determines the final size of the epidemic. This is a claim, will be shown to you later. It determines the endemic equilibrium fraction of the susceptibles in the population. What is endemic equilibrium? I will come to that. It also determines the critical vaccination threshold. So I will also show this. So let us now define what is R naught, or the basic reproduction rate. The basic reproduction number measures how many people an infected individual will transmit the disease to before they recover themselves. And it is given in a symbol called R naught. More precisely, it is the number of the secondary infections produced by an infected individual in a population that is totally susceptible. मतलब कोई भी लॉकडाउन में घर पे बैठा हुआ नहीं है, सारे लोग मार्केट में घूम रहे हैं. दिस नंबर इज इम्पॉर्टेंट इन डिटरमिनिंग हाउ क्विकली एन इन्फेक्शन विल स्प्रेड थ्रू ए पॉपुलेशन. सो हाउ डज आर इज इन्फ्लुएंस्ड बाय अदर फैक्टर्स. सो लेट अस सी. द फर्स्ट थिंग इज द रेट ऑफ कॉन्टैक्ट बिटवीन इंडिविजुअल्स एंड होस्ट पॉपुलेशन. सो द होस्ट एंड द ससेप्टेबल्स दे हैव टू मीट, एंड दिस मीटिंग इज नोन एज कॉन्टैक्ट रेट्स. एंड द प्रोबेबिलिटी ऑफ द इन्फेक्शन being transmitted during contact. If you have done the second problem, you actually know that this probability actually makes or breaks an epidemic. If the probability is halved, epidemic actually dies, if you have done your problem. So this is known as the probability or the transmissibility, and the rate of contact, if you multiply them together, they are known as the average or effective contact rate. We'll come to that when you do modeling and etc. And the other thing is the duration of infectiousness. If I am cured within 1 day, then I cannot meet many persons. And if my serial interval is 2 days, I may not effectively infect anyone. Actually, I am cured before I am being infectious. So this serial interval is also of very important, very much important. So there are three things. One is the growth rate, another one is the R naught, the other one is the serial interval. So out of them, just like normal layman's hydrostatic thermodynamics, equilibrium hydrostatic thermodynamics, there are three quantities: R naught, growth rate, and serial interval. However, there are only two of them that are independent quantities. So you can define an epidemic in both ways. In India, actually, up to April, Indian government was using doubling rates, doubling intervals. But now they have shifted to R. probably somehow Indian government was shifted from Hindi medium to Angreji medium, so it appears. So this is exercise number 4. This is just basic curiosity. You can research about it. Actually, if you look at the R naught of measles, you will be surprised. So if you have not already seen it, by the way, probably many of you have seen it already. So why is it that even though some diseases have a higher value of R naught, they are not as prevalent in certain communities as others are? This is also, there is a twist there. But I think you can figure it out yourself. I don't need to tell you that and waste my time. Now let us come to compartmental thinking. So why do we need compartmental thinking? Because epidemic outbreaks are basically modeling them compartmentally actually helps. So let us see how that helps. So if there are no immunity, you can have SIS model, SIS model or SI model, which is known as susceptible infected model. So it happens when the cured person can again be susceptible to infection. So this is known as a susceptible infected model, and this can go both ways. Susceptible can go to the infectee ways and vice versa. So this is the model. The equation number 1 says the susceptible number of susceptibles and number of infected. Actually sum to n, which is the number of populace, however, number of heads in the populace. However, it is a fixed populace. That means nobody is being given birth to, or nobody is dying. It is a perfect society. So what you can do, you can actually define your scaled infected number, scaled susceptible number, and you can write down this differential equation number 3 with respect to time, and you can solve them and you can also deduce the what is the arbitrary constants of integration, and you can solve them in number 4. That is how you can solve your SI model or SIS model. However, you can add immunity to it. If immunity is included, it is known as SAR model, susceptible, infected and recovered. So this goes single way. That means susceptible goes in terms of infected. Infected then becomes recovered. And recovered does not come back to the susceptible's way anytime soon. The immunity lasts, let's say, fairly long, say 1 year or something. So here there are some assumptions in the model. It says that the constant transmissibility, we are not changing the transmissibility and the removal rates. We are not assuming any demography. We are assuming constant population. Death and birth are frozen. And there is a well-mixed population. No lockdown. Lockdown ho hi nahi raha hai. So the SAR equations are something like that. Susceptibles are becoming infected at this rate, where beta is the transmissibility. It is actually a multiplication. This is basically the average contact rate. That means the probability of transmission multiplied by the number of contacts. So similarly, this is the removal rate, and this is how the infectious person grows or decays, susceptible person decays, and recovered person increases. These are the 3 equations. And if you can look to keep the epidemic alive, this condition has to hold. If this condition holds, then you can actually see what is your R naught. And this is actually at the beginning, because you have approximated your S to be 1 at the beginning of time. So this R naught is also known as basic reproduction rate. Why basic? Because it is the beginning of time. Reproduction numbers can actually change. I'm actually interchangeably using reproduction rate and reproduction number, but its name is reproduction number. Not means basic reproduction number. The reason being that reproduction numbers can actually change over time, and R naught delineates the fact that underscores the fact that S equal to 1 at the beginning of time. So I have calculated again R naught for the case of Rajasthan and case of Maharashtra, but I have done it smartly. And this data is from 14th March to 8th May. Same here. Actually, I have forgotten to mention the fact that it is the same for the growth rate also. Sorry. Yes. Where it is going? Yes. So it is also 14th March to 8th May. Same here, 55 days. Let us come back. I have used the same 55 days in Abscissa, but I have not used the same incident curve. What I have done, I have actually used a percentage. How many percentage of tested people has turned out to be positive? And that percentage has been plotted in y-axis and that has been fitted. There are some reasons behind it, why it is more accurate than the unnormalized positives. There are some epidemiological reasons, I am not going into them. And fitting them, I have got my R0 for Rajasthan during that 55 days period is 1.108. And here, for the case of Maharashtra, it is 1.138. So now let us press ahead. How can we do parameter estimations with that? So let us do some kind of herd immunity factor, the fifth line of R0, what R0 can give you. So you can see that the herd immunity threshold is the proportion of the population that needs to be vaccinated by vaccine or otherwise to be immune in order for an infection to be contained. So infection jo hai na wo aag ki taraf phailti hai. If there is a fire in a jungle and you don't have any means to stop it, what do? You actually at the perimeter of the fire, you arrange some dry leaves, you put it on fire beforehand. Because if the normal fire comes to the artificial fire, which is died down up till then, it leaves out some ashes. Fire can cause burn down everything except for ashes. So immune persons are just like ashes to the epidemiological fire. So what happens is that this is reached when each new case leads to just a single new case, leading to the infection becoming stable. That means it becomes an endemic equilibrium. The infection pressure becomes zero within the population, that is R becomes one. That means this is the reproduction rate. Recall that when R is greater than zero, epidemic sustains. And in this case, if you have a vaccinated populace, vaccinated plus susceptible or immune plus susceptible, normalized person should sum together as one. And this RT, this time dependent reproduction number, which is nothing but basic reproduction number multiplied by the number of susceptible people, will be given by this, where V is 1 minus, when AC is basically 1 minus V. And you know the vaccination threshold or immunization threshold is this much. And here in this is unmitigated fire in the left pane, and here in the right pane is mitigated fire. If every person, if R equal to 2, that means one person is infecting, R is equal to actually 3. Every person is infecting 3 other persons. It will be something like this. This will be unmitigated fire and it will be multiplying very, very fast. But here, two of them are basically immune, these gray dots. So what happens? The epidemic actually goes out. It is not stopped, but it actually is very much contained. It is not progressing as rapidly as it could. Infection pressure is zero. I will come to infection pressure, but the reproduction number is one. So the number of infected persons will not increase. It will not be zero, but it will be 100 yesterday, 100 today, and 100 tomorrow. There will be no increment or decrement. This is known as endemic equilibrium. So pressing ahead, we are talking about Anderson-May parameterization. So now let us talk about lambda. Lambda is known as infection pressure. It is multiplied by the average contact rate multiplied by the normalized infectees. And we can write these number 11 and number 12 equations from equation number 5 and 6. So let us first see what is 5 and 6. This is our equation number. What happened? Sorry. Going very fast. This is our equation number 5 and 6, the first two equations. If we define lambda here, we will find these two equations. This is just like putting old wine in a new glass or something, new bottle or whatever. So what does it give us? It actually gives us how the infection pressure lambda changes with time. So this equation number 12 can be rewritten approximately as this: when your S at time T0 is equal to 1. You can write this equation, and you can see at the initial days, infection pressure also increases exponentially. And lambda naught is this much. So why infection pressure is needed? Because endemic equilibrium actually gives you this. Because in endemic equilibrium, your infection pressure has to be zero. And then only you will find your herd immunity limit and your number of susceptible limit in endemic equilibrium. Now, what are those equilibrium? Lambda is force of infection that I have already mentioned. There are actually, in fact, two types of equilibrium in an epidemiological outbreak. One is DFE, which is known as disease-free equilibrium. That means R0 is zero and there are no infectees. And there is endemic equilibrium where your R is 1, infection pressure is 0, lambda is 0, and still the epidemic is alive, but it is not increasing the number of infectious people. So here we define it. And from the corollary, the equation number 16 is a direct fallout of equation number 15 here. We can actually find out this is the fourth statement that I have proven here. That is why R0 is a very useful quantity and a smart quantity. So now we are going into the meat of my talk. You may fall asleep now. So the question is, how big will this epidemic be? And can R0 answer that question also? So to answer this question, let us divide our equation number 6 by equation number 5. I can show you these two equations again. Equation number 5 and 6, divide 6 by 5. So you will find this equation. And you can see when the infected person has reached maximum number, it will touch zero. It will go to, because the derivative will go to zero, and equation number 18 can be solved. And as you can see, you can define another quantity y, which is log of S max minus R0 into S max minus 1. At the value S max equal to 1, this entire quantity y goes to zero, because S max minus 1 is here and log of 1 is also 0. But there is a root of y between 0 to 1, which can be found out graphically. If you can find that out graphically, you can plot and you can find out graphically, you know what is the size of the epidemic. For the case of Rajasthan, as you can see, almost 85% persons are actually under the hood. They are safe. Only 15% might be infected. But in the case of Maharashtra, they are not that much lucky. 50% are under the hood, 50% outside. So they might get infected. But these are, as you can see, that you should take these numbers with a bowl of salt, because I am using only a SIR model, which is a direct contact model. I am not using SEIR model, which allows for latent period or incubation period. This is kind of a very straightforward model. SIR models are never good. And also, I was taking only 55 days of data, where the lockdown was in full swing. But now, as you can see, lockdown has been relaxed, and the waves after waves are coming into. So you should take these models with a pinch of salt. But whatever I have learned, I'm just trying to pass it on. And I'm just saying that everyone can do it with R or Python and whatever. So now let us press ahead with the incidence curve. This incidence curve is also plotted for 55 days, right from, I think, yes, 55 days from 14th March to 8th May or 7th May, something. This is the daily and this is the cumulative. And why I am showing you this? Because this can give you something which is a unique feature of R, which can allows for some short-term prediction with the just the incidence curve and serial interval. Near-term predictions. In the near-term predictions, as you can see, up till June 4th week or 3rd week, the Rajasthan says there will be on the average 200 case incidences. I think you can go back in your GitHub and check. This might be very much okay, this near-term predictions. June ka mahina abhi gujar gaya hai, you can check the data. In Rajasthan, in Maharashtra, we have tried to do the same. It says up till 3rd week of June, it will be only 3,000. But actually, beginning June, it was crossing 5,000 in Maharashtra. So this actually failed, but I'm not ashamed. I'm showing you this unabashedly, because if you have the lifting of lockdown at 3rd, 8th and 17th, has not been taken care into. Even if you remove your lockdown at 3rd of May, the effect is not readily understandable up to 7th. And also, even if the 7th is recorded, doesn't matter because my data is 55 days old. So again, press ahead. I will not teach you how to plot this type of graphs. I will just tell you that R can make your life easy. Because if you go to page number 15 of this Recon website, which is actually known as Recon Learn tutorials, you can actually know the code is given there. You can plot this type of graph yourself. So again, going ahead, this type of graphs can also be very much drawn in R, and there are only 10 lines of code associated with it. Actually lesser. You have to use some libraries and a raster data. And from the raster data, you get country level, state level and district level maps. Level one, these are basically levels. There are other things. This is the country level. This is the state level. And there was another thing on the right hand side, which was IN2, which was district level. And these district level data sets has been read. Rajasthan data, district level data, and which districts are how much, kon kitna pani mein hai, and then you can actually plot it. This is only Rajasthan. But another few lines of code, you can plot Maharashtra also. So what I'm saying is that R makes your life very easy for visualization purposes also. So once we have done it, we can go to policy intervention. This is the last part of my talk. So what policy intervention does? Does a state needs to do, or why it has to do it, and if it is doing it correct or not, etc., etc., etc. So I have now trying to plot R, only R, not R naught. What is only R? Only R is reproduction rate, which is time varying reproduction rate. Now, what is time varying reproduction rate? Time varying reproduction rate is basic reproduction rate multiplied by the number of susceptibles. Number of susceptibles, and you know what is R naught? R naught is average contact rate divided by recovery rate. Average contact rate is the transmissibility tau multiplied by the number of contacts per day. So assuming that you have the same clade of virus, assuming that you have the same clade of virus, and it is not changing its virility anytime soon, only these contact rates and number of susceptibles actually make or break your time dependent reproduction rate. Now why lockdown should be done? Because the C goes down drastically, S goes down drastically. If you put people in jail, they are out of circulation, so number of susceptibles goes down, and also there by their own accord the contact rate also goes down. So it means if these two quantities are near zero, this time dependent reproduction number will also go down. So here are some plots. These plots are from 83 days or 85 days, actually 90 days, I guess, from 14th March to 1st of June, something like that. And you can see right from the 4th of April, there is a U-turn in R. This is the left-hand side is Tamil Nadu and the right-hand side is Andhra Pradesh. South of India is much more well-behaved than our this North Indian heartlands, I guess. They are very much domesticated and disciplined. And that is why I thought initially that they have succeeded. They have won their R battle in this time. So I was happy with the South India, and I was again trying to plot. Actually, I have plot nine provinces of India, not only Andhra Pradesh or Tamil Nadu. I have done it for, I think, Rajasthan also. Rajasthan is now my place of domicile and also my native place, West Bengal also, but I'm not showing it here. I'm just showing Tamil Nadu and Andhra Pradesh, and I'm showing something else also. Like the left-hand side is Gujarat and right-hand side is Karnataka. And as you can see that they have actually failed in their lockdown, because during the time beginning April 10th or 20th, they have not actually succeeded. And after April 15th or something, their R has gone up. And Karnataka, there are no marked effect of lockdown. This is just jumping and jumping and jumping. So I thought that, okay, Tamil Nadu and Andhra Pradesh won the battle. Karnataka failed, Gujarat failed. That is what my initial assumption was, just by plotting R in their lockdown. So you should know that these charts have varying ordinates. Like it is 20th, this is 30th, and then this is only up to 8th or 9th. This is only 6th. So you should be careful that the ordinate scales are not the same for all the graphs. All the graph sizes are the same, but the graph ordinate size are not the same. So my initial estimate was Gujarat and Karnataka failed, all the rest 7 states passed. The R number test, they passed. But we should be very sure that we have calculated our R correctly. So what did we do? I tried to backfit the daily incidence curve with this varying R. So double checking humne kiya hai. So by double checking, I can see that this is Gujarat daily incidence and this is Karnataka daily incidence. For the case of Karnataka, the varying R actually fits the daily incidence very quite correctly. Whereas somewhere in between, दीवार से टकरा के मेरा आर खत्म हो जाता है इन गुजरात. देयर इज ए डिले इन डेटा कैप्चरिंग एंड फ्रॉम 200 वन डे द इंसिडेंस जंप्स टू ओवर 1000 एंड दिस काइंड ऑफ डिसकंटिन्यूटी आर कुड नॉट हैंडल इट डाइड डाउन मिडवे. बट एनीवे आई कुड सी दैट माय वेरिंग आर नंबर वाज क्वाइट गुड. इट वाज reproducing the results okay. So I was happy, I could double check. But then I thought of plotting the infection pressure. Now I was surprised, because I had to say something in my paper. I had to say something that Gujarat was a failure, Karnataka was a failure, and the other states were okay. But to double check again, I tried to plot the infection pressure. And as you can see, in the case of Andhra Pradesh, as the case of Andhra Pradesh, the sharp downturn of the time varying reproduction number did not reach 1, and it actually started falling from 30. Hence, the infectiousness or the infection pressure did not flatten out except in the range of 45-75 days. Andhra Pradesh kahan chala gaya? Yahan pe. So here 45-75 days ke beech mein infection pressure zero ho gaya. Lekin uske alaba kahin bhi it is just keep increasing. Why? Because as you can say in the R number in Andhra Pradesh, it never touched 1. Only between these region, the infectious pressure gone to 0 because R has touched 1. This dotted line is a preset line known as 1 line. So similarly, if we talk about Gujarat and Karnataka, so in Gujarat and Karnataka you can see that I'll come back here. In the case of Gujarat, you can see from 20th at the very end it has reached 1. So you can see at the very end the infectious pressure in Gujarat, it has actually started reaching 0. The infection pressure started reaching 0 there, but I think here it is still artificial because they have trying a less number of testing and near 1st June, so its growth rate has gone to 0, R naught has gone to 1, and infectious pressure gone to 0 again. So these are very much artificial. Gujarat is not very hopeful, but Tamil Nadu? Tamil Nadu has actually won the battle, as you can see. At the beginning of 3rd of April, it has actually flattened. So, infectious pressure battle, jitne ke liye aapko kya karna hai? You just have to minimize the area under the curve. And this is the 1st June blue line. So, as you can see here, the infection pressure has been minimized for Karnataka and Tamil Nadu. Tamil Nadu is a known case. And it has not been minimized for Gujarat. Gujarat is also a known case. But for the other cases, Andhra Pradesh has won the R number battle. As you can see, Andhra Pradesh seems to have won the R number battle. Karnataka didn't. But in the infection pressure, the situation has actually changed. Karnataka has minimized the area under the graph of infection pressure. And it has won. Whereas Andhra Pradesh failed. So what can we say about it? We can say that not only the trend of R is important, that means the basic the reproduction rate, time, reproduction number, time varying, but also the value is important. So from where does it drops down? If it is falling down only from 5, then it's okay. But if it is falling down from 30 and never reaching 1, it has unprecedented consequences. So not only the trend but also the value is important, and that is how the public policies are important and where it is not, it can be found out. So what in passing we can say that these two failures these varying R failures states are due to different regions. Karnataka is not a failure in the same sense as in the case of Gujarat. In Karnataka, what happens, there are many more clusters and there is a super spreading event going on, literally. As I have said, I have shown in an example of a 35-year-old male in Mysuru. who has sprayed on his personal behalf 35 persons. Probably he was a paramedic. And in his note, it is written, and he, or a doctor. And he has 65 kids or grandchildren, whatever you can say, in all, children and grandchildren. So super spreading, these are the graph that actually shows you the sporadicity and super spreadingness in a state. But here it is a single graph, and this peak comes just when it should not be. This peak should have come maybe 10 days or 15 days back, but it came 10 days and 15 days later. Why? The reason being, if you go to Times of India, 28th March 2020, you will see that 1800 pilgrims from Haridwar was taken back to Gujarat at the behest of some central minister whose name I cannot take, because Hari Petter has asked me not to do that. So you will know the reason for it. So the Gujarat case, it is man-made. This nature of the graph is clearly showing migration. Here in the Karnataka, it is super spreading. So as I was telling at the beginning of my talk, data never lies. So it is only data you should trust, none else. If we go to results, we can find, these are my humble results. You can take it with a pinch of salt. And then I'm not going to read back to you because you have actually seen it. And now, what is the summary of my talk? The summary of my talk, actually, it has only one point that I want to stress, that phune bahut rayata phailaya hai. Main bhi yahan bahut der ghante se rayata phaila raha hun. You should not trust nobody, not even yourself. The first knowledge that you should take home from this talk is that the first main feature is one should not digest newspaper reports trustingly. And every report that comes from even from trustworthy sources like WHO, it will be reneged. It will be retracted within a week or so. It was actually 1 month beforehand at the beginning of the year, and now it is 1 week only. So please be careful. The second main feature is that the STEM field, that means science, technology, engineering and field, folks are very well suited for epidemiological analysis. If a greenhorn like me can do this, you can too. Then most importantly, third feature of R can be harnessed with ease for exactly that of purpose. I will open the house very soon, or Chandanji will be doing it. So these are my references. I was talking about this team charge, and all my data was public. So it is downloaded from GitHub. And this is my Professor Holger Diedrich, which alive very much. And these are other sources. I will also thank you for your kind attention. And I can also point you towards some relevant field books from where I have taken my data. These last two are basically from web sources from John Hopkins. And if you are really interested, you can go to this EpiCalc for field study. This is a field study book, etc., etc. So getting back here, now I can seek your comments and brickbats and whatever. So I stop here.
So can you, Shubhan?
Hanji.
Can you suggest some number for Rajasthan?
It suggest means what?
Matlab, the highest kind of number you are seeking. Highest number for Rajasthan? Highest peak number?
When the peak will come, or when the epidemic will be there, will be disease free equilibrium, that calculation is going on. Actually, I am hoping that one of my friend who is much more versed than me or any of us in R, because I started learning R 2 months back seriously. I actually knew R 1 year back at the insistence of my college friend from Kanpur, Kanpur wala friend, who is now in Finland. But he did maybe knowing R for much longer time. Maybe right from 2011, he knew that, or maybe even before 2009. So his knowledge and my knowledge is actually very difficult. I'm just hoping that I'm asking him to write a paper and put my name on it. So whenever that is ready, I will get back to you. Seriously, I'm on it. When the disease goes away from India.
Okay.
And I think R will give me the answer. I'm not describing the methodologies here for palpable reasons.
But this is a very nice representation how you can learn something from data, the numbers.
Yes. Actually, you should learn from data only. Now, I should not brag about it. It might sound like bragging, but who actually reneged and rescinded all the information it has told? Not only those public policy interventions, but before they said that repeat infections are not possible. There were 3 cases in April or May in South Korea. They actually said they are wrongly tested positive again. But when there was a case in USA, they had to admit that they were wrong. And they said that asymptomatic persons cannot spread. But the way in India the spread is going on, there are clusters that are forming. You can see that. I mean, in May, there was a report that 80% of the COVID cases are contained in 29th municipality, including that of Jaipur. And you see, in Jaipur also, only there are 5 Thana ilakas that are infected, like Manak Chowk, Subhash Chowk, and of course, the Ramgan Chopar and etc. But not all of Jaipur. 29 municipality areas are actually big estates. Not only maybe 3-4 wards in them each. So this is a sign of super spreading. And how super spreading happens? When there is a super spreader, and who are super spreaders? Those are asymptomatic. So in India and most probably everywhere else, only those who are spreading, those that are not ill themselves, they are spreading. Those are ill themselves, they are already out of circulation. They are either quarantined, at home or at a center. So everybody is lying, knowingly or unknowingly. That is a tall task. I cannot say that wo jo hua tha na Chichore movie mein koi hamara koi wo senior tha iska hamare anni ka, he was doing some pole dance. So I think Tedros is doing pole dance in front of China, but that is my personal opinion. You should not trust anybody. Me saying this to you has no meaning. You should only trust what the data shows to you. And I have shown that in India also, there was a person who can infect 65 others and who can infect 39 others directly and even after 25 days. And also there were instances where the infection has spread after 58 days. 2 months. That means 4 back-to-back quarantine periods.
Yeah.
Whatever the government is saying to you is basically bullshitting you. That's it. I can speak it, record it on record.
Yes. Anyone else? Yes. Krishna Mohanji, do you have some questions?
Yeah. It's a very good study. What I was looking at is a kind of a modeling. Backward modeling. I mean, because see, some of these R0 and fatality rates, they are changing with time.
Exactly.
So, if you want to capture any of these things,
Actually,
you require start with this today's data and go back in time.
Okay. I can gather 2 meanings from your question. One is that this SIR model, which is basically contact instantaneous model, there are not good because infections actually go there is a latent period between them. The other thing that I can understand is that if your infection is reported today, it does not mean that you were exposed today. There was a maybe a 7-8 days or 10 days lag at least. So similarly,
This is what I'm saying. Mm-hmm. Actually, whenever you do modeling, there are a lot of assumptions.
Right.
And
right.
Those assumptions are not in any of these disease models.
Okay.
You see,
okay.
if you know, there is a study done by the Diamond Prince. You know that there is a that ship which was not allowed to dock into any of these.
Actually, it was Diamond Princess
So from there, they have actually calculated the case fatality rate. Infection fatality rates, and also infection. What is the incubation time for this, and what is the generation time? So those are the. They are closest to the controlled study.
Okay.
And rest of the places, whether it is in India, whether it is in any country, we do not know how many people we have tested, and we do not know how many people are positive. To just give you an example, that place has estimated infection fatality rate as 0.6.
Okay.
For this SARS-CoV. But today, if you look at our fatality rates are coming to almost 10. So that means we are underestimating 10%? Our positivity 10%. 10 times, not 10%.
Okay, 10 times. Okay, that means 6%. But 6% is the highest. It is only in West Bengal or Gujarat kind of thing.
But I think in some of these places, I'm forgetting the state. The case for West Bengal, I think, probably. West Bengal is almost like 11 or 12. West Bengal, it is 11 or 12. So, at the end of the day, the organism behaves exactly same irrespective of the state, geographic location.
Okay.
So, if I take my infection fatality rate as 0.6 and compact the rest of the character, then I will know the deficiencies of our, whether it is in terms of testing, whether in terms of contact tracing, wherever
we are. You want to have that 0.6 set to be as a baseline, and what are the deficits in our system, healthcare system?
0.6 and maximum can go up to 1. Not in this study, but earlier the epidemics, it has varied from 0.6 to 1. So the way we are finding the, what we call as a guess, fatality rate is of 3 to 5%. It's very, very underestimating the infections all over the country. Today I don't believe our infections should be somewhere around 3 to 4 million. If you look at from that
There
are a lot of people who are living out undetected are asymptomatic.
Yes. Actually, that is what the serological tests are supposed to do. That the underlying populace, which are asymptomatic, which are already cured, but they don't know. And the other thing is, which my study has given me, that you remember Kanika Kapoor. She was tested positive for 7 times, consecutive times, for 2 months.
Yeah, in Lucknow.
It was lucky for us. If she was
That can be true of many people.
Exactly. That is lucky for us that she was tested positive. Otherwise, she would have gone home and happily, merrily infecting others. So, I think that has happened most of the cases. Within 15 days, nobody is getting cured. And even if they are immune themselves, they might be infectious. And the fact on the ground is actually changing every day.
Yeah.
Nobody knew that it also attacks the cranium. That means the brain. Now we know that it also attacks the brain, and even
whether it's intentional or unintentional, it has happened.
also even in a 16-year-old kid got heart attack from COVID-19. So that is also a new information. Last maybe 2 weeks, all informations are actually puzzling even doctors.
Yeah, but and see, also at the end of the day,
that there are two plates and these two plates Gujarat got.
Hey, just let me know if there is a patient with the cardiovascular, diabetes, maybe kidney problem, another thing. So he dies. So what will be the final diagnosis of the doctor? Because of which disease he died. So you will have to pick one disease. So many of the COVID deaths are mainly because of the COVID, and many of the deaths which have happened otherwise, we do not know because we have not.
Okay, okay. So yes, Madhav, in West Bengal, there was a process. They were doing it. They were saying that this is called comorbidity. That means they have died of many causes, possibly COVID also, complications and etc.
Yeah. Any person above 70, if he is dying, there are a lot of comorbidity. I mean, you should only, if you want to look at the death rate only because of COVID, then you should look at the population less than 45. And what is the fatality?
That is a good idea actually, because if you are testing, your testing should be done in a controlled manner, just like in the Diamond Princess, and also to healthy populace who are exposed only to COVID, nothing else.
Chandan Meghnani had some questions during the talk. He wants to.
Oh, really? I did not see it actually.
In the chat box he written some question. He wants to ask some question, but right now.
In which chat box? The old chat box or
No. He will ask the question right now.
I wanted to that was specific to one of the slides. So that's why I asked. Can we ask in between? So that was first thing I wanted to know. The date of onset is the date on which the sample is taken, or the date on which the
actually there was a I should come back here. I think I can show you the slides. I'm still presenting, right? I'm still presenting. Yes. So I can go to directly to date of onset. So here it is. You can see data of onset here. There is a little bit of a cheating here. This is actually, if you go to the GitHub, you will see that there is no data of onset. In India, that is not possible. It has been said this is data of reportage. I have replaced it at my whim as data of onset. So what I am assuming that there are at least 1 day, 2 day, 3 day, 4 day lag between data of reportage and data of onset. But that lag should be evenly. I mean, that is normally distributed. For some person, it will be 1 day. Some person, it will be 4 or 5 days. But it will be around, let's say, 2 and 2.5 days delayed for each of them. So I am just assuming, this is an assumption, of course, just like Dr. Krishna Mohan said, that this is an assumption that this distribution from reportage to onset, it will predate and by a mean and a standard deviation or a variance, and that distribution will be normal. That is my assumption is, and you can actually grind me with that, but okay,
what I wanted to know exactly, because there are cases when, so it has to be like, I didn't see the data set, but it is the date on which the sample was taken or the date on which the report came out, because there are lags in that also. At several places it takes they were taking 3-4 days initially, and in an initial period the reports were coming very late, but now they shifted to that rapid testing, then it started coming just the day after, on the day of the sample that was taken on
exactly.
So if we have to take into that account, but that only we can do if it is specifically mentioned in the data set.
In which state, how much time? Because it was only beforehand, there was only antibody test. Then they shifted to RT-PCR. Now they are trying to move on to serological tests. Okay, I know there are many assumptions, but and we have also seen in the case of Gujarat, there was a 200 to more than 1000 jump. This happens because of data lag. When your all the test reports are piling up and you have some delay, maybe the website uploader is on a holiday. That can also happen, and that can actually make your efforts a little bit dubious. But the thing is, there are other softwares in R also, like surveillance and etc. You can actually raise an alarm whenever you see a data discrepancy. And actually, you can just plot in the surveillance software what is your basic mortality rate in your commune. Just say your municipality, your district, your block or subdivision, or even your province. If you see any geospatial jump in data, morbidity rate, then you might say that an outbreak is imminent, even before the government or the WHO declares it in, kya kehte hain, at 8 p.m. If you run the codes, you might be, just like Dr. Krishnamohan said, that you have to trace it backwards. Because it is not that only on 30th January, COVID-19 case was positively detected in India. But was it the first, or there were other asymptomatics before? Or that went through undetected, symptomatic, but Calpol khaliya tha. So these kind of data can be backtraced. If you try to plot current data, you can actually backtrace with other suitable assumptions, parameters like serial interval, the preceding reproduction numbers and growth rates, etc. So these things can be done.
So many things I had in mind, like what if we take the data, like if we try to somehow include the days taken in recovery for every patient, because let's say if a patient is tested positive in very later stage. So actually I know a few cases like people were tested positive, but within next 3 or 2 days their consecutive tests were negative. So they just before recovering they were tested positive. So like if we can include that data, like how many days it took for the recovery after the test, then somehow if we can like take that into consideration, because like the case which you showed, like it took all you the one case which you showed, the first and the last infection of that person, the cluster which you
that is cluster of 16
charges, the cluster so 24 of yeah, so that 24 days, so that might be the case after, just after that positive he might have been tested negative.
Okay, yes, I can. You can see that this is the case where 66 size cluster, there is only one cluster of 66 members, and this person has infected this person after 24 days. But if you go back to your serial interval, you can see that there are instances people infecting each other after 58 days, that means 2 months. So I don't know, I have to check, but this data is lying somewhere here. Maybe this person has been infected by somewhere here. I don't know. So this is the data, and this is what R has given me. So what it means, Kanika Kapoor was a lucky case. She was tested positive 7 times, consecutive times. So she did not develop immunity within 2.5 months. But that is a lucky instance, because she did not go home. She did not had the chance to infect others. But there were others who were cured within 15 days, supposedly, because he or she may be infected, he or she may be tested negative. They may be immune to the disease, but they may still be infectious. Otherwise, these things should not have cropped up. So is 58 is the last? Maybe not, because my data is only up to 19th April, and this is not a complete data. These blanks are because of the fact that my contact data has only 759 entries. sorry, yes. But my line data has 17,000, more than 17,000 data within that period, the same period. That is why I had to fit it with a gamma or log normal distribution. So there are many things that we don't know. And contact information is unavailable from GitHub after 19th April because the epidemic has taken place and nobody bothers who has infected whom. But as I have said, you need to gossip. Unless you gossip, that means who is going out with whom or who is seeing whom, you are actually doomed.
Actually, I will share one case. What happened with one of my colleague in my company? He tested positive. Okay. So, and he was not going to company. He was at his house. Just before, so how he tested was like he is from Assam. So he was from Tamil Nadu. He was traveling to Assam. So there is compulsory testing in Assam for all the passengers coming there. So actually he came to our house to take the printout of his boarding pass. He was sitting with us for around half an hour and we were around like we were having dinner at that time. He was sitting at the dining table with us and next day his sample was taken and after 4-5 days we got to know that he was tested positive. And but his flatmates were negative. He came to our house. We also got ourselves tested. We were also tested negative. And like his flatmates, he was living in a like in a shared room with his flatmate for a few days. And he was also tested negative. So like actually we don't know actually now. He didn't go anywhere. And all of the people around him were tested negative. So like how can we know how he got into like who infected him? Like that's the case which you showed, the largest cluster. We don't know who is the parent of all those.
Right. So that is incomplete data. And if we don't know the parent, infector parent, the orphan infectees are known as the result of community spread. That is what people say. But the thing is, with this incomplete data, we cannot actually vouch for anything, whether it is a community spread or whether it is the serial spread, that we cannot vouch because our data is incomplete. And the other thing is that you should already know. Maybe there are some, Dr. Gulati is not here. He might have warned you in this case. The thing is, every medical test has some stochastic or statistical bias. None of the test, I think no test is more than accurate, more than 50%. That is what my native belief is, but it can go up to, if it is standardized for 10 years or 20 years, it can go up to 70-80%, but not much more than that. And this is a new test. RT-PCR was not there 3 months back or 6 months back. So this type of testing, which the tests are untested themselves actually, they cannot have accuracy more than 50%. And the other thing is that the only way to verify the test or test the test is to do the test repeatedly, maybe every day. If you repeat it 5 times and at least 3 or 4 times you are coming positive, then probably you are really positive. So this is an untested, untried medical procedure and we are trusting it blindly. This is also not very scientific because medical tests are actually has some stochastic points.
You don't trust it. I think
has given some weight for that for RT-PCR. 20% they are saying can be false negative. Like
they are saying, but at the moment it could be 100% also. I am not going to absorb that bug. 20% can come false negative, na? It may be more than 50%. Take it from me, I am not from medical fraternity. But this is untested, come on. This procedure has to be standardized, and it has to go for maybe 3-4 years, it will be standardized with the effort that is coming in.
Shubham, I think RT-PCR as a test has a sensitivity and specificity of more than 95%. Both, I mean, false negatives and false positives are very, very low. The only problem that comes is when you are taking the nasopharyngeal swab and the swab, whether the person who is taking is well trained or not.
Okay. So human error prone, आप कह रहे हो.
In the test, I think the sensitivity and the specificity is extremely. There is no other test which is more sensitive than this.
Okay, currently this is the most sensitive test available. That is what you are saying. Okay.
This is the most sensitive test available with more than 95%, even almost approaching up to 99% specificity and sensitivity.
Okay, impressive. Actually, Madhav, this is one of the best tests ever heard of because medical tests are not that accurate.
In the sample collection, if the person is not withdrawing the nasopharyngeal swab properly, because it is very uncomfortable. If the patient moves during the nasopharyngeal swab removal, so maybe there is something. This is a sample collection is the only variable, but otherwise it is very good.
Okay.
Yeah. So there are, actually here in Tamil Nadu they are taking both, like they take throat also and nasal also.
That is a normal procedure. Normal procedure is take
both
two samples and they combine.
Yeah, and yeah, that stuff like they like insert swab deep in the nose, it's really uncomfortable. I when I went, like it's like totally into the nose, and then
it is a little bit painful.
So let us thanks Shuman for this presentation.
Anyone else
who would like to ask questions? Some Ashok ji.
Maybe Ashok ji is somewhere busy.
No, Ashok ji was there. So, okay. If there are no more questions, then I thank Dr. Shubhayan for this nice presentation.
Great job. I hope he continues this work.
With all of your inspiration, I will. Of course, sir. So let us.
I realize that our young people in this society should also learn about the R, because R is very, right now this is the age for data processing, and also R is very helpful in that, and you can do wonders.
Yes, it has taken the benchmark, that is right.
So okay.
Thank you all for attending this lengthy discussions and talk and etc. So I thank you on the behalf of society and on my personal behalf also. Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir.